craving. What's common to sweets, smartphones, and sweatshirts? They all start with the letter S. But there is a deeper connection than that. It took me a lifetime to connect the dots, and I hope to get the essence for you within 20 minutes this evening. Like most people, I'm fond of sweets, of ice creams, chocolates, and cakes. Like most people, I rarely ask the question, where does sugar, the key ingredient in all this, comes from? It most likely would have stayed that way, but for the curiosity of my roots. I grew up in Hyderabad, a city in South India. My grandmother, like most grandmothers, was full of stories. There were stories about her husband, my grandfather. Grandmother would say, your grandfather was handsome, and he was educated in South Africa, and he had great handwriting. And there were stories about my great-grandfather. Grandmother would say that he worked hard all his life, yet died a poor man in tragic circumstances. Apparently, great-grandfather spoke fondly about Durban and Natal, places in South Africa. Apparently, he said, Gandhiji is a great man, and he met him in South Africa. So as a youngster, I'm growing up with these stories in my head about something to do with South Africa, my ancestor, and Gandhiji. An interesting family tree project. In my 20s, I started writing to researchers in South Africa seeking their help to find my ancestor. And one of them said, Krishna, it is very difficult to get information about indentured coolies. That was the first time I heard the word indentured coolie. I looked it up online, and what I saw shook me up. 1.3 million Indians were shipped off as indentured labor to replace slaves on sugarcane plantations. Slavery in modern times began in the 1440s. By the time it ended in 1830, you had close to 12 million human beings taken from Africa as slaves. 12 million human beings. Can anybody guess where most of them went to work? America is not the right answer. Less than 500,000, less than 500,000 slaves actually came to America. Out of those 12 million, more than 6 million slaves went to work on sugarcane plantations. They went to work in the Caribbean and Brazil. In 1833, when slavery was abolished, the demand for sugar was exploding. Everybody wanted to have sugar in tea and coffee and desserts. The plantation owners petitioned the British government that now that there are no slaves, you need to give us a lot of cheap labor. And India was part of the British Empire, and so started the Indian indenture. Life of an indenture coolie was the same as that of a slave, almost. Most of the slaves never left the farm. To leave the farm, an indentured coolie needed to have a pass. You would work dawn to dusk. The slightest of transgression would get rewarded with whipping. Your pay, your rations, could get withheld at the whims and fancies of these owners. Female coolies would get paid half the wages and half the rations for the same amount of work. And female coolies were sadly sexually exploited all the time. One evening, as I was looking at this indentured picture where everybody is now reduced to a mere number. Thunder struck me. The timelines that I was thinking about, my great-grandfather, sugar indenture, Gandhiji, South Africa, all lined up. That evening I knew that my ancestor was one of those 1.3 million indentured peoples. From then on, it was no longer a family tree project. I wanted to know my roots. I wanted to find my ancestor and find my body. For the next decade and a half, I buried myself in ship lists and databases. What you're seeing here is about 20 odd rows of a list of coolies, which had more than 150,000 rows. By the end of the search, I practically memorized the whole thing. I realized that, alas, this ship list was imperfect. Imagine you in the lower deck of a ship with about 400 to 500 coolies in a space which is probably as big as this auditorium. And after 4 to 5 months on a rocky ocean voyage, when you land, you could have an officer in Guyana or Trinidad or Mauritius or South Africa asking you your name. Quite often, there were no interpreters. So the coolies would not understand what the officer is asking. And they would say something. So the officer would write your name as he heard it. So I would look for names which sounded like that of my ancestor, send them to the researchers in South Africa, and wait for weeks. And as it turned out, the replies were always negative. So this cycle of failure, of hope, of promise, of defeat, went on for years. And in 2014, I gave up. By that time, I had done everything humanly possible. I wrote to practically every researcher in South Africa. I went through every database, every ship list, but I failed. I failed my ancestor, and I failed myself. At that point, I thought the only thing I could do is maybe go to South Africa and stand on the same soil that my ancestor probably did once. So in December of 2014, I bought a 4-day ticket to South Africa, and I went. On the second day, it was Christmas Eve, and this is an archive in Pietermaritzburg. Most government offices in South Africa are closed from the 20th of December till New Year Eve for the holidays. But this archive was open, although for half a day. And a miracle happened that day that I can never, ever get the right words to explain. In that archive, I found the original ship record of my ancestor. This is my great-grandfather VIRIAH, and these are his sons, and this is my grandfather. So the journey that began as a teenager finally ended in an archive in Harrisburg, and I found my roots. I went on to write a book. It took about 4 years to write, and it was published earlier this year. And while writing the book, I was happy that sugar indenture is dead. Slavery is dead. I was rejoicing. But I was wrong. Can anyone in the audience guess what this is?
Part of a cell phone? Part of a smartphone?
Almost right. This is a lithium-ion rechargeable battery. This is what powers each and every smartphone that you have. Cobalt is a key ingredient in each of these battles. As we speak, there are more than 5 billion smartphones out there. And they are projecting to sell 3 billion more. So, lot of cell phones out there, which means lot of batteries, and which means lot of demand for cobalt. More than 60% of the world's cobalt comes from Congo in Africa. Of all the cobalt that is mined in Congo, a fifth of it is mined by hand. Ironically, it's called artisanal mining. Trust me, there's no art in this. There are almost a quarter of a million people and about 50,000 children who work in this artisanal mining. Children as young as 6 work close to 12-hour days, and with their bare hands they dig at earth and they break it down with small hammers, they wash it with their hands, and they fill it up in sacks to take it to these traders in the evening and hope to get paid. The miners, with very little safety equipment, dig tunnels which are hundreds of meters down. Day after day, rain or shine, and no holidays. In Congo, in the last decade or so, there's been a significant increase in lung diseases, in problems relating to birth defects, because continuous exposure to cobalt fumes and dust is causing such grave illness. But this death and disease rarely gets reported. You have about 43 miners who died in an accident in June this year. And at the end of all the hard work that these people do, when they go to the trader decides how much would you get. On a good day, an adult might get $1 to $2. $1 to $2 at best. A child gets 50 cents. Apple, last year, made $200 billion selling smartphones. Coming closer to sweatshirts, an average American owns about 60 garments. T-shirts, trousers, jeans. The amount of garments that we throw away equals to about 1.5 times the Empire State Building every day. The world of fast fashion means a lot of demand for garments, which means you need a lot of people to sew. Enter Bangladesh, the world's second largest exporter of garments, where more than 4 million people toil, most of them women and children. They work 12 to 14 hours a day. There is no sick leave. There is no overtime pay. And women in a lot of factories get half wages of that of men. And I keep wondering, the conditions for living and working have not changed much since my ancestors' days. Workers in Bangladesh work in very cramped spaces. There are a lot of accidents. In 2013, the world's toughest occupational accident, if I can call it, happened in Bangladesh. There is this 8-story complex called the Rana Plaza. It collapsed, and you had close to 1,200 workers who died. 1,200. And more than 2,500 100 people were injured. And after all this time, how much would they get paid? The living wage in Bangladesh till recently was 5,000 taka, which is close to $60 per month. With great difficulty, it has been increased to 8,000 taka, which means $90 per month. So most of the workers in Bangladesh get paid between $60 to $90 a month. Clean Clothes is an organization which does research, and they spoke to 20 of these brands. In the audience, I'm sure everybody has at least two, if not more, of these brands: Uniqlo, Nike, Adidas, etc. They ask these brands, can you tell us if all your workers get the minimum wage? Guess the number of brands which said yes. Zero. Clean Clothes said, okay. Can you tell us if half your workers get this living wage? Guess how many of these 20 brands said yes. Zero. Clean Clothes finally said, 25%. Can you tell us if a quarter of your workers get the living wage? And one brand said yes, and that was Gucci. And they said, we can do it for the workers in Italy. So that brings us back to the question, what's common to Swedes, smartphones, and sweatshirts? There are millions of people out there who live and work in conditions unimaginable, just so that we have this convenience. These people, their words are real. And what does that mean for us? To me, the first step is to acknowledge that these words exist. It's a reality. If you acknowledge, then comes the possibility of acting. To me, all of us can do one thing. We can smile. Smile at a construction worker. Smile at a worker who is paving the road. Above that, each one onto their own. Here are four websites where you can find information, you can volunteer, you can donate. And as consumers, we can create a great impact. We can ask questions, we can demand. Where does this raw material come from? How are you treating the workers? And this holiday season, your shopping choices is a reality check. This holiday season, your shopping choices is your reality check. Thank you.